Constance and Zaruba Kobadi. I'm going to be facilitating the discussions that we're going to have today, which is basically talking about banking and finance. The topic is Fund the Future. We have decided to invite the specialists that we have today. Obviously, they are coming from different backgrounds to share their experiences with us. Hopefully, we're going to learn from them. And in terms of the things that are going to be discussed here, the topics, they vary from the credit crunch that we had sometime in 2008. And I think we're still feeling the effect of that. And it's going to also talk about occupier movements as well, which are some of the things that I think we just see as headlines and we don't spend a lot of time reading about the impact of these things in our lives. I remember when I was reading one of the books that was talking about the credit crunch, some of the things that came up were talking to people with developing certain products, and the CEO of the banks, they were not aware of the nature of those products. And when Alan Greenspan invited the CEOs to come and explain some of these products, what they ended up doing, they were inviting the 23-year-old who developed these products. And which I think it was, in my view, it's a big challenge. One of the motivational speakers that I had today who was talking, he mentioned something, some of the points that were raised by one of the highly respected CEO in America, who said that 20% of the people that you have in your organization are top performers, 70% are people that you can replace when they leave, and 10% are people that you should, in fact, be looking at firing them. My question is, you as someone who's firing someone, where do you belong? Do you belong to the 20%, the 70%, or to the 10% that should be fired immediately? I'm going to actually allow our panelists to actually talk on these topics. I don't know, maybe we can start from the other side, because I don't know if you can start on your side. If you can just maybe introduce yourself, because I'm actually worried here that I may pronounce your names or your surnames incorrectly. I'm a product of Bantu education, which I think I should just mention that in part of my intro. And some of the things that we learned there, they come handy sometimes. We've been taught, not as a subject, but as a habit, that to sit at the back is a privilege. So now you can always assess the age of some of us by looking at where they are sitting in the room. I can see that the front seats are somehow empty. So it shows that people are not that young. Thank you very much, Cas. Over to you.
Thanks, Zveli. My name is Cas Coovadia. I'm Managing Director of the Banking Association of South Africa. And firstly, thank you to the organizers for inviting me. And what I'm going to do is just say a few introductory words and then try to address the issues that the organizers have asked us to address here. Obviously, as a representative of banks in this country, we are to a certain extent in the gun sights of many people and the targets, even what's happened internationally. I'm certainly not here to defend the banking industry or anybody else. I'm just going to put a few thoughts on the table and then let's debate them out. Firstly, we talk of the global financial crisis and the global economic crisis, but in effect, and I really revel as an African coming from an emerging continent to say this, because it wasn't a global crisis, it was a US and European crisis. And given the geopolitics in the world and given the economy in the globe, it had an impact on the US's and Europe's trading partners and others. So it was essentially a US and European financial crisis that led to a US and European economic crisis that then led to essentially a global crisis economically. I think the crisis has, in certain quarters, and I think more broadly than one would usually assume, has called into question the sort of tenets of capitalism as they exist today. But I also think that most stakeholders would agree that capitalism, not the way it's been practiced, but capitalism as an economic system, is probably still the most effective economic system to promote growth and social redress. But we do have a new normal now. Joe Marcus, the governor of the Reserve Bank, is very fond of using this term. It is a new normal. The crisis has, I think, fundamentally shifted the way we do things. And that new normal, I believe, within a market-based capitalist system, include some appropriate role for the state. And we're having this debate in South Africa at the moment. I'm not a supporter of significant state intervention. So I don't think governments should do something very well. But I think the sort of usual phraseology we used to use, that we leave it to the markets. The markets say this and the markets say that. I think the primacy of the markets has been brought into question. And I would prefer debating an appropriate state role going forward rather than the state essentially using taxpayers' money to socialize certain financial institutions, which is what has happened in Europe and America. So I think that's something we need to debate. I also think that we need to a certain extent, hark back to capitalism as it was, which was a market system that rewarded hard and honest work, a system that produced goods and services and had a long-term approach towards wealth creation. And it's what we probably coin today as sustainable capitalism. It's not the capitalism of short-term wealth creation. It's not the capitalism of just moving money around. It's not the capitalism of creating fancy instruments. It's the capitalism of creating productive capacity, enabling the financial sector to play a critical role in enabling through financing such capacity, promoting growth, promoting innovation, and having a long-term approach towards all of that. So I think it is a new normal. But I'm convinced that it's not, the answer is not to look for a new economic system. I think the answer is to see where we fail and what we do about those failures. Let me then just address some of the questions. The first question was whether a banker is still worth anything or worth his or her salary. You know, banks are, there are some people, very few I meet, who say we can do without banks. We can't do without banks. To some people, they are an evil that you need to deal with. To others, they are institutions you need to deal with. In some form or other, they affect your lives every day. So banking as a profession and banking as an enabler for the economy is here to stay. But I think that what the crisis has brought about is a term that some people also use, is to that banks need to become glass banks. They need to be more transparent. They need to disclose more. They need to interact more with people. We're looking at ways and means in this country of optimizing the banker's role in financing productive capacity, financing the real economy. And I think those are the sorts of things that banks are going to be called to do. So is a banker still worth it? Absolutely. I think there are very many good people, solid people, working for banks. And I think it would be incorrect and I think not constructive at all to say that bankers are therefore to be tarnished with a single brush. The issue about the remuneration and so on, again, it's a big debate in our country. And I think we fast getting to a situation where we are, not just as banks, but as business, going to actually have to show that remuneration is linked directly to performance. And if that performance is over a longer term, then that remuneration should be linked over that longer term and not remuneration now for results that might be expected in 10 years' time. So I think that people must be paid what they're worth. They must be paid for what they deliver. Obviously, issues of supply and demand around particular areas of professions come in. But I think that the days are gone where people put into place instruments whose results are probably seen in years to come and are rewarded now. So the interaction between performance and remuneration, I think, is going to become sharper. And I think that will determine how remuneration is based. Second issue, correlation between index performance and green business. In South Africa, green business is fairly new. In the financial sector, it's pretty new. In the banking association, it's only in the last 2 years that we've actually started looking at sustainable finance issues. But I have no doubt that green business will become a critical element of business anywhere in the world. And as our companies and as our banks become more globalized, green business is going to become an essential measuring tool of any performance index. Will there be a correlation between index performance and green business? I think there will be. We're beginning to see it in South Africa, the JSE SRI index, for instance. Carbon disclosure projects and instruments like that are actually giving some companies the competitive edge because they are actually excelling in those areas of the economy. So I think that definitely will be a correlation. The occupier movement. I come from an anti-apartheid activist background. So as far as I'm concerned, as a matter of principle, responsible agitation and mobilization by civil society has got to be good for any society. I think any society would be the weaker if we do not have ordinary citizens mobilizing around particular causes in a responsible way. I don't believe in students protesting because they don't have good educational facilities and in the process protest burning down the facilities they have. That's not responsible protest. But responsible protest, and we had plenty of responsible protests pre-apartheid, pre-democracy. So it's got to be good for a society. I think the agitation, the question to me is, what do you agitate and mobilize for in the current context, in the financial and economic crisis context? And my view is that I think the Occupy movement should be mobilizing for and agitating for involvement in structures that actually begin to address in a real way the weaknesses that the current system has actually shown. And I think it is up to society as a whole, and particularly in this case business, I think, and bankers, and particularly in the States and Europe, to actually begin to really hear what the Occupy movements are saying, and to begin to develop mechanisms to actually involve and put those views structurally into the real discussions about what we're going to do around the weaknesses that have actually come up. So, in principle, I am fully in favor of phenomena like the Occupy movement. But I believe in responsible agitation, mobilization. I believe in being pragmatic about what you can achieve and agitating around that. And I believe that it's the responsibility of those who are being agitated against to actually begin to hear what's coming out of them, begin to involve that in some sort of structured interaction to inform some of the changes that need to happen. issue of responsible investment. I happened to be all of yesterday morning at a IFC session on responsible investment and the role of pension fund in that. And we all reach agreement very quickly that it's not a question of whether responsible investment is the thing to do. The issue is how you do it. There's absolutely no doubt that even in this country, the King Report, the New Companies Act, other instruments promote and actually, in some instances, enforce responsible investment. So the question is not whether responsible investment is the way to actually do business, but how do you do it? It's also not just what you invest in. So it's not just a pension fund saying we're not going to invest in liquor because it actually has a deleterious social impact on people. It goes beyond that. It's on your own governance structure, in the way you conduct your interaction between the employer and the workers. It's in the way you ensure that your boards are properly structured. It's in the way you ensure good financial management. It's in the way you interact with not just your direct stakeholders, but a range of stakeholders who might be impacted by the business you do. So responsible investment is not just where you put your money, but also how you put that money and how you conduct your business. In the South African context, I think we have particular socioeconomic challenges. And in my view, responsible investment must go some way towards actually meeting those challenges, together with government. But not anything investment. It's investment for which a return is asked and must be received. But I think that a discussion is necessary between government and business and the financial sector, and we're beginning to talk to government about these issues, on how can you enable private capital to actually work with government to meet some of the socioeconomic needs we have. So is it just government's role and the fiscus's role to fund all the clinics we need in this country, or is there a possibility of structuring relationships between government funding and private sector funding to actually make sense on how we do these things? Also, the whole area of broad-based black economic empowerment in this country. I think some aspects of broad-based black economic empowerment fall at the center of responsible investment. In a country where 6 odd million people are, 6 odd million households are without housing, if you investing in initiatives that actually provide and finance housing, that's got to be a responsible investment. So I think that there are issues, in particular issues in the South African context, that we need to identify within the responsible investment debate. But internationally and globally, it's the way to do business. We need to start figuring out in South Africa how we do that. The financial sector's role in creating a sustainable future, I mean, there are a couple of ways. Directly through banks lending money for housing, lending money for small, medium enterprises, lending money for development agriculture in the South African context. All of that is creating a sustainable future. So in the way we do our business directly, we begin to impact on a sustainable future. But then also in protocols we have with our own customers. So if we're funding a mining operation, not just because there's legislation in place now, but because from a sustainable futures point of view, it is incumbent upon us to begin to interact with our customers to say that we're going to fund this, but this is the sort of behavior we expect. And to play some role in actually encouraging our customers to themselves behave in a sustainable way. So I think those are some of the ways the financial sector can play a role in creating a sustainable future. Changes on the horizon for banks and finance, I think both internationally and locally, there's significant regulatory change coming. I mean, one of the impacts of the crisis significant regulatory changes in Europe and America. I must say that as a banking sector in this country, we are actually feeling hard done by some of those regulations. Because those regulations are being put into place to address some of the bad practices by banks in those localities. The banks in this country did not have a financial crisis, did not have a banking crisis. But we are still going to be subject to those international regulations because we are part of a global community. And we will be measured when we go and do business elsewhere on whether we are abiding by those regulations. In South Africa, it creates a particular problem. Because in South Africa, we have to have the fine balance between an internationally recognized, globally top-of-the-range banking sector, and we're the second most effective and efficient and stable banking sector in the world, according to the World Competitive Report. But at the same time, we have to broaden financial services to reach the majority of the people in our country. Regulations mean more cost, mean making banking more expensive, and that's a balance we need to create. In this country, there's going to be a significant regulatory overhaul. The National Treasury has put on the table a document where there's going to be a significant overhaul of the regulation of the entire financial sector. So the regulatory issues are critical. I think on the back of the crisis, issues of transparency and disclosure, and we've been constantly challenged about that on fees, on charges, and so on. If we say these are fees, then convince people, be transparent about it. Disclose how you arrive at it. Disclose how you deal with certain products and so on. Then the whole area of market conduct, protecting your customer, treating your customer fairly, are big issues that are coming to the industry in the next few years, and I think will have a significant impact. Thanks, Willie.
Thank you very much, Cas, for sharing that with us. Can I just make a request that maybe just on some of the points that are coming from the agenda, if maybe we can just maybe pick up a few, and then if the time permits, then we can add as part of discussions. I would like to just, what I'm going to do is, after we had all the speakers, I'm just going to actually open the floor for discussions. Thanks.
Okay. I'm going to stand for two reasons. One is I injured my knee at gym and it's sore and it's bent. And the other is so the people at the back and I can see each other. And then the other one is it's some deep sort of psychological thing that apparently it makes me look as if I speak with some authority. So I don't know if that's true. Now I'll start speaking to the mic. Firstly, I'm glad what Cas said about the meltdown, and I'm going to say much of what he said, but I'm going to say it in a much more extreme form. Unlike him, I don't have to be diplomatic about banking. Unlike him, I don't have to be diplomatic about government. So I'm going to shoot from the hip. My expectation is that I will offend everyone in the room a little, and probably Ryan next to me a lot. So with that caveat ahead, let's go for it. Firstly, on the question of a meltdown, Cas modestly said there wasn't really a meltdown. Let me stress that. There was no meltdown. There actually was no crisis. And if you don't believe me, all you have to do is go and look at the world growth figures for countries throughout the period, and you will see a very small number of the world's 200 countries, perhaps 10, had actually contracted for a year or two, as we did for 1 year. Most had simply a slowdown in growth rates. And so if you ask an economist where was the evidence for a crisis, or if economists in 50 years' time look back at the data for this period, they will not see what they would call a crisis. If they read the papers, they will, because there was a crisis. It was specifically a banking crisis, more specifically not a banking crisis, but a subprime mortgage derivative crisis, to be technical. That is to say, people who invested in subprime mortgage derivatives of the United States, they had a crisis. The reason was that the subprime derivatives were government-backed. They were actually created by the American government. In other words, It's very odd when people say it was some sort of market failure, very peculiar, because they were a deliberate American government policy. They were a policy, by the way, against the banks. It's bizarre that the banks get blamed for the crisis, because what the whole purpose of Freddie, Fannie, Ginnie, and the other what are called government-sponsored enterprises, GSEs, please bear that in mind, what we would call parastatals, they were created for the sole purpose of doing what responsible banks wouldn't do and didn't do, namely issue subprime mortgages. Subprime is the American term meaning not creditworthy or toxic mortgages, to what were called ninjas, people with no investment jobs or assets, no income jobs or assets, okay, the ninjas. So what would happen is banks, who now sit here sounding as if they committed some sort of sin, would not have done that. They didn't do that. And in order to get the ninjas funded, the American government created these giant entities, massive entities. The sole purpose, they had only one purpose, which was to create subprime or ninja mortgages. That's what they did on a massive scale, 75 million of the things. And what they did is they said to the banks, if you lend money to people you wouldn't normally and responsibly lend to, we will back the mortgage. And bankers said, this is fabulous. So they employed agents saying, go and find the village idiot, bring them in, we'll lend them $1 million to buy three houses, another million, whatever, because the government miraculously turned a stupid mortgage into a risk-free mortgage. Now just think of how fabulous this is. The bank comes along and says to the government, we'll pretend it's him because he likes the government, comes to him and says, here you are, here's the mortgage I lent to the village idiot who can't pay. The government says, fabulous, and pays the bank 100% of the nominal value of the mortgage, thus miraculously converting a high-risk mortgage into a zero-risk mortgage. Then the government sits through its national, its Freddie and Fannie and others, with these government-sponsored GSEs, parastatals, and it says, what are we going to do with all these mortgages? It doesn't want to manage them. So it puts them into bundles worth billions of dollars and sells them to international bankers and governments, like the Greek government, the Icelandic government, the British government, and Lehman Brothers and Goldman Sachs and others. It says, buy these mortgages. Now, of course, bankers aren't stupid. They often speak as if they think they're not very bright, but in fact are very bright. And so they say, why on earth would I buy these idiotic things? And then the answer to that is they're government-backed. The American Treasury underwrites them. So the Greek government and everyone else buys these things by the trillion until eventually, as the markets look at the calculations, say, but the American government can't afford to back all of this toxic mortgage. And then the bubble starts bursting, mortgage prices start falling, and then the American government says, we can't have that. Trust us, we will prevent this. And they prime the pump with more monetary, easy monetary policies, Alan Greenspan, who just issue more and more and more money to try and prevent the bubble bursting, which of course just meant the bubble got bigger and bigger, and when it burst, it was a bigger burst. That's how bubbles burst. That's what was inevitable. And by the way, it was predicted, it was entirely and obviously predicted by anyone like me who understands and supports market economies and understands that that sort of government intervention is a really dumb idea. Now, let's understand the rest of the crisis. As Cas says, a handful of Europe, not even all European countries, only a few, minority, even had a contraction. They must just have slower growth. The Greek government, what do? This is sovereign debt crisis. Again, understand it's the government that's bankrupt. So we have here, governments regulated the market. Now they say we want more of what failed. Financial markets, after all, have always been the most heavily regulated sector of the economy. So why don't people say this is a failure of regulation? So having failed to regulate, they now say we want more of what failed. It's a very strange response to a failure of regulation, is to say we want more regulation. So the Greek government is now bust. So we have now an insolvent government called sovereign debt. And then we say, oh, somehow capitalism has failed. So all of these governments create these things, invest in these things, go bust, and then somehow capitalism and the market is to blame. Now, this is a very strange logic, very perverse and peculiar logic. So let me immediately say there is no case at all for more regulation. There is absolutely a 100% watertight case that regulation failed dismally at what it promised. And in case you want to know about the extent to which they promised it, just go and look. Google statements about government-backed mortgages and bubbles and subprime crisis going back to the 70s and 80s, and you will see that politician after politician said to the public, don't worry, we have all the regulations we need, everything is sound, the market is sound, the institutions are sound. They did quite the opposite of say, we don't have enough regulatory power. So let's understand that the very people we now want to give more power to told us they had all the power they needed and told us because of that reason everything was secure and we didn't need to worry. Having failed, we now say give them more power. Very, very strange response in my view. So if we move on from that, then it says, is banking needed? Should banking stay the same? Yes. We need to go back to the belief that banks are the best and only people who can decide whose money to take in. And bearing in mind, banks don't lend their own money. They lend our money. Savers, depositors, they are merely a conduit, an intermediary between the people who save and the people who borrow. My personally, I don't think the banks should be into such questions as sustainable environmental policy and so on. They're not equipped to do that. They're financiers. They must stick to what they can do, should do, did well, and would have done well but for this absurd subprime mortgage intervention. And in retrospect, by the way, they haven't given up. Freddie, Fannie, and these government-sponsored enterprises are carrying on as before, as if nothing has happened. It's quite weird. They're just working away at creating the next subprime mortgage bubble. It's as if they've learned nothing. It's quite strange. And yet they sit there pointing fingers at the commercial regular banks who do only viable, sustainable mortgages by choice, logically, as they should, with my money. I don't want banks going out there and lending money recklessly, which is what they're being encouraged to do. And they should stick to what they know, which is finance, in my view. They shouldn't be bullied into going into all sorts of stuff which is not their turf or their know-how. Then on to, as to the Occupy Wall Street and other movement, the Occupy movement, let me just say that like Cass, I'm 150% in favor of freedom of speech, freedom of protest, and the right to be wrong. Freedom is the right to be wrong, and they are wrong. So let me just explain why they're wrong. They're wrong for this very clear reason. They firstly carry on about inequality, as if somehow the wealth of some causes the poverty of others. One person being rich explains why another person is poor. You don't have to be a rocket scientist to see why that's nonsense. The fact is that if Steve Jobs becomes rich because he invents iPhones and so on and so forth, he has not become rich by making other people poor. He's become rich by enriching other people. That is what capitalism and free markets do, is they have people being rewarded for coming up with good products, good value, good exchanges, good technology and innovation. And then the interesting thing about it is the people who seem to make the most money with the least risk and investment are, interestingly, not bankers, not entrepreneurs, but who are they? They're entertainers, sports heroes, authors of best-selling books, multi-billionaires. Nobody seems to mind them. Nobody seems to mind Oprah being a multi-billionaire. I don't. I'm very happy about it. Or sports heroes or whatever, Michael Jackson and so on. But this idea of picking on people who make money by supplying goods and services, which entertainers do as well, and sports people, the service of playing good sport and singing well and so on. By the way, I've offered not to sing if people pay me enough, but I haven't yet got my offer met. So I'm really at risk of actually singing, and then people will start rewarding me. But the point is, people who make money by free trade, free exchange, make money by virtue of how much they offered other people, how well they served people, the poor. The other thing about this wealth income disparity thing is it doesn't care about the poor at all. For example, one of the leading books in this field is the one by Tony Judd called Ill Fares the Land. I mean, most of you might not know it, but it's a best-selling book that's kind of in sympathy with this idea that somehow inequality is a bad thing. And in it, he's got lots of facts and figures about the income disparity and the Gini coefficient and the difference between rich and poor. Not one sentence in the book is devoted to the condition of the poor. He doesn't care about the poor. He's obsessed with the rich. That's why they carry on about the 1%. For some reason, being rich is presumed to be bad. Yet nobody says, why do the poor always and everywhere on the planet migrate in one and only one direction? That is from countries with less of a free market to countries with more of a free market. From socialist countries to capitalist countries. The poor know something the intellectuals don't. The best place to be poor is where you're free, and where nobody cares about the rich, but where people care about the poor. Products for the poor, jobs for the poor, services for the poor. And if you care about the poor, then you would do what we do in our daily work. You would be working with the poor. Trying to, for example, today they were busy raiding the window washers at the corner of Greyston and the freeway. Those are the people we care about. We go out there and we say they have a right to earn a living. Not a right to harass people, not a right to obstruct traffic, not a right to be done, but a right to earn a living. The people who worry about the Wall Street demonstrators don't spend 1 minute with the poor. They don't care about the poor. They care about the rich. They hate the rich. They want to destroy the rich, as if destroying the rich somehow is going to help the poor. It won't. Because in the countries where you... Everything, by the way, that's good for the poor is good for the rich. So if you say, how can you alleviate poverty? How can you create jobs? How can you raise living standards? How can you get houses and loans and clothes and food? Every answer to that question is something that happens also to be good for the rich. From the policies you come up with, rich people will benefit. So to try and have something that's good for the poor and then somehow knock the rich is certainly a contradiction in terms. As to what's sustainable, I don't really know what the word means in this context. In the terms of finance and banking, sustainability is borrowing and lending responsibly. That's really what sustainable banking is. Sustainable banking is not about, you know, how many people have solar-powered lights on farms or whatever, or renewable energy, all of which is fine. I happen to be involved with trying to promote a particular kind of renewable wind energy, so I'm all for it. But it's not the business of banks. Sustainable banking is responsible, sensible banking, the way bankers have done for hundreds of years and hopefully will continue doing for the next few hundred years and will not be disrupted and subverted by ill-conceived and mistaken ideas. Now, finally, I want to say one of our questions was the role for the state. Cas talked about the role for the state. Do you really want more of a role for the people who caused the problem? I just don't get it. I just don't get why, when it's quite straightforward. It's 100%. The crisis is 100% government. It was a failure of the government's regulations in the most heavily regulated sector of the economy. It was the promotion by the government of toxic mortgages. It was the investment by European governments in toxic mortgages, therefore having a sovereign debt crisis. Governments are bust. Governments are insolvent. We should be very clear, this is a failure of government. So you really don't want more of it. And then finally, let me just say, I think underlying all of this is, what are the differences? The differences are actually a very fundamental, philosophical, profound paradigm difference. Some people are in favor of personal freedom or liberty. That is to say, they want free choice. Those people will always tend to come out on the side of the market. It doesn't matter how rich people are, it doesn't matter what happens, just leave people to be free. Let them decide for themselves which entertainers become billionaires, which sports heroes, which authors, which bankers, whoever, which technology inventors. On the other side, you have people who hate freedom, who are what are called the French word dirigiste, want a directed, controlled society. They don't like the idea of people deciding for themselves. They want Big Daddy, Big Brother, a paternal state controlling the lives of everybody. That's the difference. And depending on your personal paradigm, your personal philosophy, whether you respect ordinary people and their right to decide for themselves, you come out on the side of markets. If you don't, you come out on the side of regulation, things like the Consumer Protection Act. which says you may not decide for yourself what you buy. You may not buy cheap vehicles. You are forced to buy a guarantee with the vehicle. That's the one mindset. You cannot trust consumers to make their own decisions. They will be made for them by regulators. Versus the other view, that liberation, freedom, empowerment means people deciding for themselves. I want to close off with one little observation that's relevant to banking over here. In South Africa, most of the people in this room are black, and I'm going to make a statement that's relevant to race. And it's this. Do we in South Africa now, in the new South Africa, 16, 17 years after transformation, trust blacks with freedom? The answer I expect to get is yes. Let me just put this to you. We have about 10 million properties possessed by black South Africans already in the former, in the so-called historical black areas, townships, locations, settlements, tribal areas, and so on, without freehold title. Right now, we are working with one city council in South Africa where we are trying to convert 50,000 black-held properties to the same freehold title of the white properties in the historically white area, where, of course, an increasing number of blacks live. And I, of course, know there are no longer such things as white and black areas. I'm talking about predominantly. In the black areas, they still have preemptive clauses. They may not sell, they may not mortgage, they may not let, they may not trade. And black South Africans still are held under house arrest under verwoerd laws, which say that you will occupy, the person who must occupy the property is the person to whom it is allocated by bureaucrats. If you are found out of your property, it is repossessed. We read about this in the paper with great pride and flourish. Some farm that was redistributed is taken back because the government didn't like the way the black farmer was farming. We haven't taken away white farms. Houses are repossessed as RDP houses because the wrong person is occupying them, a relative, a friend. Someone has moved on because they've got a job. As for banking, my view is the banking movement in South Africa should say enough. Give every black South African household a full freehold title free, with no strings attached. Treat blacks as free people who have the responsibility and capability of deciding for themselves. Surely, surely we've reached that point. And we've reached the point in the world where we should treat all people like that, which is what free economies are about and what the banking regulation denied and plunged us into the crisis in a small number of countries. Africa, by the way, throughout this continued growing at record rates. We weren't touched by the crisis. South Africa itself, one or two other countries, had a year of contraction, must continue booming. South Africa now is some of the highest growth economies in the world, sub-Saharan Africa. If you look at the graph without giving you the year, you wouldn't be able to say where the crisis was. It never affected most of the world significantly or even detectably. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. I'm going to sit at this level with you, equal. My name is Ryan, and it's actually Ryan Resource-Based Economy G, as I'm known on Facebook, from the Zeitgeist Movement South Africa. We are a non-governmental, non-political, non-religious movement creating awareness and educating people about the core issues the world is experiencing at the moment. Everything you see around the world is governed by money, from prices of goods in the market, from healthcare to service delivery. The quality of these depends on the price you pay. In order to keep this system and yourselves alive, you have to keep spending money. The current monetary system needs consumers, advertising, and marketing to ensure that there are enough consumers to go around. However, this profit-driven capitalistic monetary system never takes the environment or its employees into consideration. How can it? It needs to look after the bottom line. We at the Zeitgeist Movement advocate a resource-based economy. In the RBE system, resources are managed and monitored so that we don't overmine or deforest resources faster than they can be replenished. Products are to be made to last a lifetime in order to break the cycle of cyclical consumption. For example, your mobile phone is designed to break down in order for you to buy another one. Or your PC becomes redundant after a year, as there's always a newer model or essential upgrading to be done. Only the best of every item is created, thus eliminating waste. Goods and services are to be provided freely without the use of money. As we are the people creating these goods and services, a common ground can be reached where, through your contribution to society, you have access to what you require. Education is free for life. As you know, an educated person can only benefit his society or community he finds himself. That's he or she, by the way, sorry. Those industries that can be automated need to be automated immediately to increase production of those items so that there are more people freed up from repetitive, boring jobs. People will be educated and trained to do specific jobs that add value to society. Work hours have to be reduced in order to allow more people the opportunity to work and gain experience, freeing up people to pursue that which they really want to. Food production. Everybody has to eat. All communities must be equipped in order to produce the finest organic, wholesome food for each other. As for providing housing, this will also be provided for without the use of money, as there is not enough money to provide for everyone. We will need a shift from the need to accumulate to a society that can provide for itself through positive contribution to the upliftment of humanity. True equality with the monetary system out of the way, there will be no need for crime and corruption, as the goods and services you require will just be ordered and provided. The global economic meltdown is a result of the fiat currency monetary system, where all money is created out of debt. Banks create credit out of thin air. About 5% of all the money is physical. The other 95% is digital. The real issue is not what bankers are paid, but how money is created. The Occupy movement are the result or symptoms of a flawed monetary system. We need solutions, not protests. One would be to scrap fiat currency and third parties providing loans and charging interest. There is no such thing as responsible investment in this competitive economic system, as the mindset is geared around profit. The most beneficial investments are not profitable, as profit entails cutting cost by all means possible, like labor broking, cheap imports, or lower grade materials used in production, and that once again affects the bottom line. Change the monetary system to a resource-based economy. The wealthy are only wealthy on the back of hard labor, whether it is honest or exploitation. Get rid of the fiat currency and put credit creation in the hands of the people. Capitalism seeks profit over people, community, even countries, for exploitation of resources or cheap labor. Capitalism, socialism, communism, and the free market do not take the environment and a planet of finite resources into consideration. All of those systems are governed by fiat currency based on fractional reserve banking. If you are born into money, you'll likely remain wealthy. If you are born into poverty, you'll likely be exposed to poor health, poor nutrition, poor living conditions. This global economic monetary system perpetuates these conditions because it is profitable to be sick. It is profitable to eat healthy food. It is profitable to be schooled privately, profitable to degrade the environment, food, and water supply. I'm going to end this with the Indian Cree prophecy. Only after the last tree has been cut down, only after the last river has been poisoned, only after the last fish has been caught, only then will you find money cannot be eaten.
Thank you, by the way.
All right.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. If you don't mind, I would like to stand so that you don't need to dodge each other to see me. I would like to see all the faces. I must say, I am quite honored to be in such a diverse panel discussion, so maybe I should just introduce myself and tell you my 2 cents worth that I would like to add, and we continue and rather get back to some of the questions. So, first of all, I'm Marco Lotz. I am the Nedbank Group's Sustainability Carbon Specialist. So the complete left-hand side of my job will be calculating Nedbank Group's carbon footprint, assessing our water consumption, also to a large extent where the money of the bank goes to, what does it influence, what does it fund, all of those type of things. Then I need to get, with a great competent team, we need to get Nedbank to carbon neutral status, and then we enter the carbon market. Nedbank Capital Carbon is a big player in that market. And remember, I'm from Nedbank, so the Nedbank brand will pop up frequently. Please blurb it out as some banks' advertisements do and change it to any other bank. I just want to tell you more about the context than anything else. Apologies. Moving towards the right-hand side of my job, it is feeding into the integrated energy plan, integrated resource plan, renewable energy feeding tariff, but that somehow changed somewhat, carbon tax developments, and all of those type of developments. So I've got a very specific and biased add-on, and I want to declare that. And I think it's also very important, if we go through the opinions on the panel, to also understand that, look, we've got biased opinions, and the following is mine. So, first of all, let's start with how much is a banker worth. I love this question because I'm an engineer. so I work in a bank, but look, what I do find in banks are, and it maybe gets back to some of the points raised previously, that there's only a certain spread of things that a bank understands, and that's going to be net present value, internal rate of return, payback period, and that goes to Leon's point that banks should stay and stick to what they know what they can do, and it goes to Mr. G's point of what a bank aims to do and so on. So I don't even disagree with these people, but I think they agree with each other without saying it explicitly. So that's one of my points I would like to raise. But going on to, is there a correlation between index performance and green business? Now, Nedbank Capital has got a project called the Green Index, and that tracks the performance of companies based on their sustainability criteria. And many companies outperform other companies on the basis that they are really sustainable. May it's a journey. We do realize that it's not perfectly sustainable, and it really depends on, getting back to a previous point raised, what is defined as sustainability. If you talk to a union, it is, let's create jobs. Whatever you do, as long as you create a job, that is deemed sustainable. If you talk to extremely left party greenies, they will tell you, whatever you do, don't harm the environment, let's fire all the people in the mine, it's a dumb idea to take stuff out of the ground, and so on. So sustainability has got various definitions. So let's also be conscious of that and see between cultural sustainability, social sustainability, environmental sustainability, and economic sustainability, we need to weigh certain parts of how we interpret sustainability. So going on, what is the financial sector, or what constitutes responsible investment? This is a good question. In my opinion, again, it goes back to the previous point that if we take a look at sustainability, taking into account all four components, we need people to have a good job. We need people to actually earn money. We need the environment, otherwise then it's quite detrimental if I've got all the money in the world, as the quote said in the end, but I've got nowhere to live. And as the one quote also goes, there is no planet B. So this is what we've got. So how do we use this, taking into account that mining, for example, in a certain definition cannot be viewed as sustainable because you are taking out a finite amount of gold, for example. That's one way of viewing the world. Another view is, look, with that money that you, or with the gold that you were able to take out, many mines have proven to be completely sustainable, long-term sustainable, because they fund many other things. I mean, even BP changed their slogan to Beyond Petroleum. So isn't that an interesting twist? It, also, if you take a look at the countries from the Middle East at COP17, end of last year, they started to argue that they should also get some of the development funding because they need to change from oil to something else. So the world is really changing. Now, also, getting back to the point, should a bank be involved in sustainability? Leon, and yeah, I agree with you to the extent that a bank should fund whatever is a solid business case. We cannot fund sustainable practices just because somebody calls it sustainable. So let's say I am Philips and I make a new CFL which is very much energy efficient. That is a green product and it can also make money. But I cannot continuously fund projects as a bank, talking out of a bank's point of view, if it is, you call it green because the capital side or the investment side of a bank said no thank you. Now you go to the sustainability part of the bank because you want to push it through. So sustainability shouldn't be seen as, oh, shame, the thing doesn't make money, so let's just throw money at it until it works. We can't do that. But there's an enormous amount of opportunities within the green spectrum, within the sustainability spectrum, for banking products, and also for physical products like energy-efficient lighting, maybe a Volkswagen Blue Efficiency car, and so on. These products are hitting the market, and people are benefiting from the fact that they pollute less. So historically, we had this very difficult choice between either you make money or you are sustainable. If you put people in front of that choice, they will most probably have to pick, let's make money, because then you can pay salaries and you don't have to close up your business and so on, the obvious side. The trick is, how do we now move into a world where we make money from being sustainable, and being very specific, we make money from having green products? And that is a great challenge. But look, that is a challenge, and that is where we need to head to, and that is where the next goalpost will be. So, and there's an enormous amount of pressure on banks to get those product offerings into the market. But remember, a bank will fund whatever is legal and whatever makes money. And if the green bank doesn't fund it, then the blue one. If the blue one doesn't, then the red one. So let's be honest about this. So in banking terms, a lot of the stuff that we also do, going back to what Cas said, is working on the background on some of the legislation. So what is permissible to fund in mining terms? How much money, according to the equator principles, are you allowed to have into invest into casinos and so on? So, look, do I really think we should stop capitalism, and do I think it's a bad idea? No. Do I think it works absolutely perfectly at this stage? Definitely not. So I remember the statistical lecture I had, he said, exams isn't a perfect system, but it's the best we have. So I feel the same about capitalism. It's the opportunity. It's giving somebody that carrot to say that, you know what, if you get, as Leon also said, if you get to develop the new iPod, well done, you're gonna coin it. On the other hand, if you don't, then all the best, it might be a difficult life. So how do we incentivize opportunities? Moving on, what changes are on the horizon for the banking and finance industry? Now, for me, the one phrase I want to say is carbon tax, and then everybody sighs. Now, the carbon tax is but one development, and Cas, again, it's always a privilege speaking after you, because you paint the industry so broad and so wide. So a carbon tax is but one aspect. There's also the Kyoto Protocol. There is our issues with water. There's the long-term mitigation strategy. There's all these other abbreviations like the IEP, IRP, all those things that I said that's part of my job to fit into. So carbon tax and how you internalize the cost of the environment is but one aspect. So an example I like to use is, in the early 90s, if you told somebody that you're going to go to the shops, you're going to buy your groceries, and then you're going to pay for a plastic bag, they would have told you that you're crazy. And today you pay for a plastic bag, if you want one, whenever you go and shop. So that is one form of internalizing environmental cost. If you add a monetary value to something, then all of a sudden people think twice before they throw it away or use too much of it. So, and then going to point six, as we've got on page 26 of the brochure, what is the significance of the Occupy movement? That's the whole sentence. So, for me it is, we need to realize, and banks, we struggle with this, but we need to realize that fighting something because it's legal and it makes money is not good enough anymore. That's good enough from a top-down approach. If the legislator allows you, then you can fund it. But your constituents, your shareholders have a problem with that. Your employees have got a problem with that. And that's crucial. So the whole world is changing around in that we've got a bottom-up approach. And that is where the Carbon Disclosure Project and the Water Disclosure Project also feeds in, where it's a friendly disclosure of how do you impact the environment as asked by the investor and not by government or regulator. So I want to finish off, and I'll gladly take questions in the end, that for me the focus is on the opportunity. There's many opportunities. There's also a lot more consensus than what we actually think. So, that's something I like about my language in Afrikaans. If somebody asks you, how was your day? Then you can say, no, it was a good day. Or you can say, yes, it was a good day. But it was, both people had a good day. And I find exactly the same in many of these discussions, that we can start with yes, we can start with no on a specific question, but there's a lot of consensus. And we actually need to start with the consensus and from there work forward. So that is me. We've got two more panelists. I'm eagerly awaiting their input, and from there we take questions.
Can I talk first, possibly? Yes, you have something to say.
I'm very pertinent, but you can
not go ahead.
I'm sitting in awe listening to the four previous speakers. And I really don't want to go over what they've gone over for a number of reasons. I want to come at this from a different direction. So, forget the questions. I want to look at, so is this a crisis? Firstly, let me say I'm noted as being a non-executive director of the port's regulator. I came at 10:30 this morning to the port regulator telling the National Ports Authority that they'd asked for 18% increase in their tariffs, and we gave them 2.76. So I'd rather not be known as a port regulator in case there's somebody outside waiting for me. Secondly, like my friend on my right, I'm an engineer, and my life has been involved in the maritime industry. And to say that the crisis is in banks and in governments, it's actually on the ground. I want to talk about one part of the industry, and I use it because we're sponsored here by a yacht building company. In 2007, South Africa was the second largest yacht building, multi-hull yacht building country in the world, employing direct employment over 4,000 people, an income of around about 1.2 billion, significant training, upskilling, management training, development and research, and those sort of things. When the economic meltdown, as we've been hearing, happened, for whatever reason, that industry collapsed. Less than half the number of people are now employed. The export market went down from over a billion to around about 300 million last year. People are out of jobs. Training has stopped. There's no future for a whole band of young people trying to enter industry. So what's needed? Okay, the industry made a lot of mistakes. it didn't realize that the environment in which it was operating had changed. That in fact the high net worth individuals were no longer spending money in America and in Europe, and the new high net worth individuals were spending money in the BRIC countries. That industry in China is growing at about 150% per year. They're building 47 marinas. There are a lot of them, people. So that our industry was probably staring into its navel and didn't realize that something was going on. So they missed what was happening. They also missed that, in fact, there are still a lot of rich people around, but they didn't want what we were producing. They wanted something new. But the industry had so reduced that it wasn't able to spend the money on research and development in materials, in processes, in new models, and that sort of thing. So the industry shot itself in the foot. So what did it do? It said, we need new investment. So where did they go? Who gives investment? Two of them are sitting on my right. In other words, we have a situation where an industry, and I think there are a number like it, this is the only one I know about, who, in order to redevelop the industry, needs to go to the financial institutions and say, guys, we can employ 4,500 people. We can probably double that in the next 4 or 5 years. But we need money to invest. And the answer? We're into green light bulbs. Or we don't know anything about your industry. Or we've got other things in mind. You're a very small beer compared to mining and agriculture. So I just wanted to bring aside, I'm not in any way attacking what my learned colleagues have spoken about, but I do say that there are other aspects which need to be considered within the financial investment banking group, which looks not only at the front newspaper stuff, also looks at some of the smaller sectors of our economy which need the development, which will grow areas. Many of them are in the marine field, in fishing, in boat building, in the harbours, and in coastal shipping. We've not been able to interest the banking, finance, government industries in that field. And I think that's one of the aspects which should not be forgiven. So to my friends on the right, I've been very awed by what you've said, but we do have some other views. Thank you.
I am going to stand, and I can't use a microphone because I'm deaf in my one ear, so I can't hear myself speaking. But I'm Garth Carstens, I'm a representative of Dean Catamarans, and we decided to be a co-sponsor of Tomorrow's Leaders Convention for a number of reasons. One, thank you, Dr. Gowans, for our invitation to come through and speak a little bit about the marine industry, the South African boat building industry specifically. We do have a problem. We have huge opportunity within...
I think the purpose of this was for recording.
Okay, can I put it there? It'll pick me up. Pick me up. I'll speak pretty loud.
That should be okay.
There's huge opportunity in boat building for generating foreign income. Dean Catamarans, as an example, we export all of our production. What I know about banking, quite a lot. My father was a banker. My father, in actual fact, the older people sitting in the back, is that correct? Well, you would know my Carstens. My father was a director of nedbank for many years. My late father, should I say. And my brother-in-law, Stephen Panos, probably a lot of you know Stephen. He was a treasurer of an Investec bank and a founder of Equinox Bank. So I've got a view on banking, but I don't want to share that. And I don't want to take up too much time here. I'm more inclined to listen to people like Ryan and your points of view. I like that. The reason we're at Tomorrow's Leaders Convention is that we as a company, as being Catamarans, are concerned about the future of boat building in South Africa, but the future as a whole and who those leaders are going to be. We spent a lot of time on developing just by the bind, to just use this forum to just share something very, very quickly, because I don't want to speak too much, because I have nothing to say about banking or finance. But Ryan, you know, saving the planet is great. Corporate social investment is important, and the agenda that I got to speak on is completely different to the agenda that you gentlemen have. All I have was to talk about a topic that doesn't get enough exposure or should be spoken about within banking and finance, and that is the real issues that we should be looking at. Big organizations, big banking and financial institutions is poverty eradication, skills development, and job creation. Concentrating on those realities, because that's what we want our leaders of tomorrow to be concentrating on. I want the CEO of the bank to be cognizant of the fact that tonight, when everybody's had a great day and great food, that there's 1 million children in South Africa that will go to bed hungry tonight. And it's quite incredible. I always thought that South Africa had the most sophisticated banking infrastructure in the world. I've just been corrected. It's the second most sophisticated banking infrastructure in the world. I've done many, many presentations on poverty eradication. I'm an advocate for change. We're trying to integrate black equity into boat building. We're trying to do a whole bunch of things. But when it comes to the future of this country, and I think the reason for this Tomorrow's Leaders Convention is to have leaders who are going to go out, and lead our country, to lead our commerce, to lead our industry in a manner that takes cognizant of the fact that we have some serious problems that we are not addressing. There's a lot of hot air. A lot of people talk about poverty. I don't see the private sector, and I don't see the public sector doing anything about that. And that's what we wanted to address. And I've spoken to a lot of people at this convention. It's been fantastic. Just the wonderful ears that have been lent to me to talk about not only our industry and how our industry can create jobs, that can create foreign income and all the rest of it, but also people that are lending their ears to, yes, how can we address the issues of poverty and skills development and job creation? Well, he's run off. I don't want to waste anybody's time. Dean Catamarans is very, very happy to have sponsored the banking and finance breakaway. And I do believe that the people that are here on the panel think that you're going to get a lot of mileage out of it. Thank you so much. Nice meeting you all.
Thank you.
Well, in the absence of a facilitator, how about just audience time?
Well, I'll give it a go. As a trader at GS and in the hedge fund industry in London, I lean pretty far right economically. But if you'll excuse me, I'm going to be deeply blunt and potentially offensive. Mr. Louw was. Ms. Louw, it's the logically, factually, and academically blind talk that you gave today that actually discredits many good reasons why free markets are good. And I'm worried, as a young person, that if we don't actually grapple with the real issues in a constructive manner, we're not going to have free markets going forward. And I think, for example, your comment that you repeated a number of times was regulation is flawed, and therefore why would you want more regulation, more of a flawed thing, is the most blindingly obvious false dichotomy I've seen. It's crazy. It's a statement. If I have to phrase it as a question, I'll ask you, do you genuinely believe that false dichotomy, and do you genuinely believe what you said today, or was it to be extreme?
The answer is yes.
Okay.
Okay. Can I just take a mic?
Can you explain why you think it's a false dichotomy?
Well, to give you a very simple example, if you had bad regulation and you increased regulation, but you made a good regulation, that's not bad. Yet it's more regulation. So
that's a clear false dichotomy. I mean,
Let's just be clear about this. We have here the sector of the economy which is A, the most heavily regulated sector, B, the one in which we were assured over and over again is responsibly and adequately and well regulated, and C, where government didn't like the way the banks were dealing with the regulation, so they created the bubble.
Look, I completely agree with you.
Yeah.
I think you're skipping a lot of steps and ignoring a lot of responsibilities. As someone involved in the industry, I think that's true. I think what's important to acknowledge, though, is why what you're saying doesn't lead to your conclusion that more regulation is bad. Now, personally,
I think that
more regulation is probably the problem. You want to go into a type of regulation that's more, it's more market abuse FSA type regulation than the insider trading regulation in the States, if that makes any sense, but it's more principle as opposed to directive, okay? But your point that heavily regulated industry, we were promised it was well regulated, therefore equals less regulation is better or equal regulation is better. It just doesn't logically follow.
We can do this in two ways. One is the generalization. The cliche out there is we need more regulation. Okay, so that's the cliche. So I'm saying as a cliche, as a generalization, it doesn't make sense because we had lots of regulation. Why is the assumption that regulation in the abstract is going to be better than regulation we had? That you seem to agree with. So my next point is, if you want to be specific, the question is what specific regulation is being proposed? In other words, if somebody says what we need to do is, for example, go back to what preceded the Clinton reform, which allowed investment banking and commercial banking to coincide. Many people think it was Bush, it was actually Clinton. I think the answer is we can argue against that because that's the norm all over the world, so why would that cause a crisis? Okay, so what I'm saying is, as a generalization, the argument doesn't hold water. We need more regulation. If we get to specifics, what's being proposed is no solution. So, in other words, on either count, if you want to, for example, suggest to me a specific regulation, we should do X, be very concrete, then we can debate that. But what I'm saying is to say that we need more regulation in the abstract, which is what is being said, that's the cliche, then I would say that makes no sense. So, to say that the most heavily regulated sector of the economy needs more regulation. It seems to me if the most heavily regulated sector of the economy has a crisis, and let's be clear, that's what it is. It's not a meltdown, it's not a depression, it's none of those things. Has a crisis. The question to ask is it not probable that what failed was the regulation? Whereas if we look at sectors like urine hedge funds were least regulated of the financial products. They are the ones that had the least of a crisis. So we have here a correlation between high regulation, high crisis, low regulation, low crisis. I'm just saying that tells us something.
No, I see. You see, if you'd stood up...
Okay, can you just take another question?
Yeah.
I do understand this is one of the... you're probably going to be very busy this afternoon, Leon. but I think... Maybe let's just give other speakers a chance.
Yeah. But they could respond to this as well, of course.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Chris. I've got two questions which are interrelated. And I would like to ask my questions to both Cas and to Leon. The first one, and before I maybe start with, I must just acknowledge, as you know, like everyone who is South African in this room, I'm very proud of knowing the fact that either we're first or we're number two in terms of, you know, having stood up to a test in terms of what happened in the banking sector. It says a lot. However, being a black South African, one question really remains very high in my mind. We have seen new legislation coming up and, acts probably sometimes coming up trying to transfer wealth from, transfer into black ownership. And I feel like this area is one area where really we haven't done much, in my view. We can talk about our leadership, having managers and, executives who are black in banks. However, when it comes to ownership of the banking sector, it still lies, almost 100% in white hands. And the question that comes to me really is, don't we think, we have reached a time, 16 years after the new, South Africa is coming, for black hands to now start sharing in the ownership of the banking sector? And if you believe, both of you, that we should do this, is this a role that should be taken by government? I want to believe that one of the crises that we have right now in this country is that we are not really reaching out to the black market. And for one of the reasons that I've seen is that we don't really understand the black market. We have principles which applied pre-1994 still being applied to reach out the market today. For example, if you go and apply for a loan, the same questions that were asked 16 years ago are still the same today. So issues of do you have collateral, do you have an address, things like that, which a lot of people don't have. I happen to have banked, to have done business in East and West Africa. And one of the things that surprised me a lot is that, and I don't know if there's anyone from some bank here, is you find that in certain African countries, people don't even have an ID book, yet they had some business one way or another with the bank. And I ask myself, why is that a problem in my country when we are said to have the second, most prestigious banking system in the world? So that's the question that I have. I think we need to have shareholders owning banks who also understand the people that come from, who bank with them. The second question is,
is that a comment or a question?
No, it's a question. I was asking them, don't you think it's time to have, black ownership of the banking sector? And if that's the case, should government be the driver or who should it be? The second question, which is interlinked, it relates to job creation. Now, everyone has come up, government is talking about job creation. There are sectors that we know of, transport and logistics today, renewable energies. Everyone is talking about job creation. I want to know, what is the banking sector doing? Now, there are many studies that have been done globally which have proved that jobs cannot really be, driven by government. In actual fact, the SME market is the biggest contributor to job creation in other parts of the world. If you go to Japan, if you go to other, much more established nations, you realize that you need to create jobs at the SME level. Now, I'm starting to think that probably banks need to change the outlook of how they assess credit. For you to give loans to to entities in a recessionary environment or in a changing environment like where we are, you cannot be applying the simple toolbox rule of saying, have you been in operation for X number of years? We need to almost do things differently. Now, I understand the profit motive has to be there. However, behind a company, behind a shareholder, there's a human being, I believe. And I think it's about time that we're actually responsible to say, well, are we tackling the problems of the world together as individuals, as human beings, or are we going to look at how much profits we can make and keep wealth?
Yeah.
Okay, can I kick off?
Okay, no, that's fine. I was just wondering if I can maybe take this question and then can I ask that maybe we just confine to one question at this
Thanks. My question is really directed to both Leon and Cas. I think you spoke about the fact, you allege that there was no crisis, and I guess what I'm trying to get out of you is that which laws out of the laws that we have in the country can you state out, particularly in the banking sector, that you say that you can prove that they're not working? Because I think in my view one of the reasons why South Africa survived the crisis was the very same laws that you're coming here and you're telling us they were wrong. And if you're saying more regulation is wrong, I want you to also comment on what the Treasury is suggesting now, that there should be interbank charges. I need you to talk about that, because the reason why I'm saying this is that in a state like South Africa, where most of our people are uneducated, you are going to have a problem where the rich will obviously have an advantage to exploit the poor. And if the state does not intervene, then we have inequality, which clearly to be on is not a problem. It's normal to have inequality.
Okay. What I'm going to do, I think you can respond, but your question will just be after.
Sorry, I was going to respond to that question over there.
Okay, that's fine.
Okay. And the second question. Yes. The way banks do business in South Africa, you're comparing it to Kenya, for instance. Firstly, there are regulations in South Africa that compel banks to actually do things in particular, which don't exist in Kenya. So asking for addresses, asking for identity documents. If banks didn't have to do that, they wouldn't do that. We have a financial intelligence center office in this country that demands you do that. And if you don't do that, you are breaking the law. When we launched the Mzansi account 5 years ago in this country, it took us 3 years prior to that to get an exemption from the FIC office that we should not be asking people living in informal settlements for addresses. It took us 3 years to get that exemption to enable us to launch the Mzansi account, which was aimed at people who weren't in banking. So I think we do need to appreciate that when Leon says regulation, I'm not saying no regulation. I'm saying there needs to be appropriate regulation. We have regulation in this country that actually thinks that we are a first world developed country. We forget that we have serious developmental challenges in this country. And that's not appropriate regulation. Okay? So we have money laundering regulation that even a developed country wouldn't be able to meet. But we are expected to meet here. So I think when we compare ourselves to different jurisdictions, also look at the sorts of regulations we have in this country that make banking very difficult sometimes. Having said that, you know, I think that we keep on saying that banks aren't targeting the black market. That's where the business is. Every bank worth its salt, nedbank, the big four, have serious community banking divisions whose full-time job is to penetrate the black market, because that's where the business is. It's not in a white market anymore, in the retail environment. It's in the black market. And they're doing all sorts of stuff, from cell phone, mobile technology, to Standard Bank opening up banks, essentially putting a Standard Bank sign outside Paza shops and trade shops in rural areas where people are going to be able to do banking. They've got 3,200 of those at the moment. Now the thing is that there's a hell of a lot happening in trying to penetrate the emerging market. And not because banks are good guys, but because that's where the business is. So SMEs, not bank figures. I can't remember who did the study now, but I quoted the figure a couple of times. 94% of SME funding in this country comes from banks. 94% of SME funding comes from banks. And people say banks don't fund SMEs. It's just not factually correct. I do banks have a hell of a lot more to do? Absolutely. But have we made tremendous progress in the last few years? I think it's just not correct to say we haven't. Let me just talk about the ownership issue. And we've had this debate for 5 years in the financial sector charter. Okay? You can't say compare ownership of banks to ownership of a manufacturing firm or a mine or anything of that sort. Banks primarily are owned, not only in South Africa but internationally, are institutionally owned. They're owned by pension funds, they're owned by mutual funds. Why? Because the registrar of banks will tell you if a bank gets into trouble, before I bail that bank out, I want the shareholders of that bank to put money on the table. So you want to own a major chunk of a bank, you better have deep pockets. The banks that say you want to own 15% of a bank, show me your balance sheet first. Because when that bank goes up, I'm coming to you before I use taxpayers' money to bail that bank. Now, so
It's not whether it's white owned or black owned. The majority of shareholding is bank is institutionally owned through pension funds, because banks are the sorts of institutions that need to go to the market all the time for capital. And who takes up that capital? It's the institutions that take up that capital, not individual black or white people. In the last 5 years, banks have done black economic empowerment ownership deals worth over $100 billion. Okay, so but we've argued at the Charter Council, as a banking industry, is that that's all well and good, and quite honestly, it's of no interest to me. What's of interest to me is how much are we putting into housing, how much are we putting into SMEs, into agricultural development, into access to finance, because that's where real empowerment and transformation happens. I don't care if Patrice owns a part of a bank. No business of mine. What's my business and what's really important to me is what is that bank actually doing to build houses, to fund SMEs, to fund agriculture, to give people access to financial services. Because that's what's going to bring about real empowerment on the ground. So I think that we need to begin to look at our priorities. On your issue about crisis, I didn't say there's no crisis. I said there was a crisis. You don't say there's no crisis. But the issue about what sort of regulation, for instance, we in the banking sector have no problems with the fundamental pieces of bank regulation, which is a bank sector. But then, Leon referred to it, we have the Consumer Protection Act, we have the National Credit Act, we have the Financial Intelligence Center, okay? We have the Financial Advisory and Intermediary Services Act. All of these things are there to actually say we need to protect people. It's not there to regulate banking, but all of that makes banking expensive. And what happens? The costs get passed on to the consumer. Okay, now, what? And people smile at me. Let me tell you, just let me finish off. A very prominent politician 3 years ago told me, Cas, why aren't you people lending money in that sector? So I told him, okay, chief, which bank do you bank with? So he told me. I said, okay, give me your account number. We're going to take all of your deposits and we're going to lend to that sector. And if that sector doesn't pay back, don't come and squeal with me. You say, no, that's not what I'm talking about. Okay, banks aren't profit. The profit motive is one part of it. The most important issue for banks is that they've got to lend money in a way that protects depositors' funds. That's why we're heavily regulated. Not because we lend money, but because we take your money and we protect your money. And when you walk into a bank tomorrow and want all your money, we can't say, sorry, we lent it and we didn't get it back. We've got to give your money back to you. Okay, so I think that it is important, and I'm not making any excuses, it is important for all of us to understand a bit more the sort of institution these things are. And that's a debate that's an ongoing debate. And maybe we're at fault. We don't actually publicly debate that often enough. In a way. So,
just on that point, maybe you will come on that one. I think just as an addition, I would like to just get clarity, because there's something that I think to some extent is a contradiction from financial institutions. And the argument that to say, look, because we're taking money from the depositors and we have to lend responsibly. But when you look at one of the things that was actually raised here, one of the points that was raised is it's about the banker, okay? And if you look at what has happened in other countries, you have people that were raking millions and millions in their capacity as employees, in their capacity as directors. Now, they are taking the money that belongs to the depositors. Now, can we try and maybe in our response balance that to say, okay, fine, although we're saying that we're taking money from the depositors, and we cannot just lend recklessly. Are you not just paying people recklessly when it comes to compensation?
Since I'm holding the microphone and you mentioned my name, my view is I can think of only one correct person to decide how much someone gets paid, and that's the person who pays them. So if the shareholders who are, in the case of banking, as Cas pointed out, mostly institutions, and I very strongly urge you all to look up the research of the WITS economist, I can't go into it now, but it's actually quite fascinating. The only person who's done empirical work on who owns institutions that I'm aware of is Vivian Artut, the economist at WITS. And it turns out that there not only is a very substantial black ownership, but it's rapidly rising. And she makes the point those are ordinary people, investors and savers. And that's what matters, as I think anyway. But let me just to make this observation. It fascinates me that people engage in a debate about what other people should be paying. Now, I do not have an opinion on the right amount to pay the CEO of Goldman Sachs. How could I? The people who must have an opinion on that are the people who pay the CEO of Goldman Sachs or Standard Bank or Nedbank or whoever. That is to say, the owners. And the owners happen to be institutions, and institutions happen to be ordinary people, members of trade unions, people with pension schemes and medical schemes, and in South Africa, the Public Investment Corporation, which is something like 98% black owned, is the single biggest investor on the Johannesburg Stock Exchange, and so on. So I would say let them decide. If Kosatu thinks that the CEO of some bank is being paid too much, let Kosatu go to the AGM and call to pay them less, and then Kosatu won't do that for the very obvious reason that the person they want, who is worth 20 million to the bank and is paid 10 million, that means 100% profit, they will chase them to somewhere else that doesn't stop that, doesn't have a cap. So I would say the only person to decide is the person who pays, and the person who pays is the owner. I, as a depositor in the bank, have no opinion on what my CEO should be paid. I trust the people who own the bank to make that decision. I don't see how I can have an informed opinion on that. And if they make the wrong decision, I want them actually to pay the person a lot of money to get them out of the way and get someone in who is worth it, who's worth more than what they get paid. On the question of Cas listed these laws that make it difficult to bank, I want to put it in South African transformation racial terms, which is what you were trying to raise. Let's understand this very, very clearly, because it's very easy to not call a spade a spade. And the one thing about me is I don't want to beat about the bush. Let's take the Consumer Protection Act. Just one section of it. It's a very long act, and I'm going to mention only one section, just so we can all be clear about what it does. It governs banking. It says to bankers, banking has to be dangerous, difficult, and costly. In Kenya, for example, banking is done over cell phones. People make loans and do transactions over cell phones. In South Africa, that is illegal. It's banned. It's forbidden. We may not have banking in South Africa that is normal in Kenya or Ghana or many other African countries. Juna Rungo, a businesswoman in Kenya, is a pioneer of the business that you can contract, SMEs contract loans over the cell phone. Here you would have to be screened, you would have to be vetted, you would have to sign documents, they'd have to be lodged with a credit registrar, etc. One section of the Consumer Protection Act says that anyone who buys a used product, now that includes a piece of mining equipment, a motor car, a cell phone, a microwave, a projector, anything, any used product, must have a guarantee that is better than the normal guarantee. In other words, you may not buy footstoots anymore. That's banned in South Africa. So now, a peasant farmer who wants to buy a 10,000 rand bucky and fix it himself or herself may not anymore. That now must come with a full guarantee against all defects at the time of sale forever into the future. No limit. And anything that arises in the first 6 months. Now, what that means is if you ask anyone who runs a motor, you know, mechanic, how much extra would you have to charge to provide the guarantee required by law? And the answer is 50 to 60,000 rand for everything that is sold. Now, what that means is poor products are banned. We need to understand that this isn't a regulation of suppliers, this is a regulation of consumers. And it's a prohibition on the sale of cheap things. And who are the poor? Black South Africans. I'm chairman of NAFCOC's Regulatory Committee, which is Black Business Organization of South Africa. That's my world, by the way. That's the world I work in. Only one bank is a member of my organization, and then it's only to upgrade Kenya and black areas that we have an association with them. So I don't speak for them. I'm glad I've created somebody to the radical side of the case so he can speak more of what he really means. But let me make this point. The doors for small businesses and black South Africans closed on the day the National Credit Act came into force. The organization with which I work, NAFCOC, supported the National Credit Act because they think their members are credit receivers. They are now crying because their members are no longer receiving credit. They went from credit receivers to credit non-receivers. And why? Because it is simply now too costly, too risky, and too difficult to provide credit to anyone except a rich person. And I want to close with this one statement. My bank is in Sandton City. I'll mention the name, Standard Bank. It did what any other bank would do. My private banker phoned me. Now, just make it into the income bracket that has a private banker. Okay? She phones me. She says to me, Mr. Louw, this is within 6 months of the National Credit Act coming into force. Okay? Mr. Louw, we noticed that you are underborrowed. Would you like some credit? You know, build a swimming pool, go on holiday, buy a new car. And I said, no, on the contrary, I've paid off all my debt. Actually, you can cancel my mortgage. No, Mr. Louw, you shouldn't do that. This gives you access to credit, whatever. So I said to her, I know what you're doing. What you're doing is Natasha Naidu is her name. She says, I say to her, what you're doing is you no longer give credit to people who need it, and you now want to give credit to people who don't. Those are the only people you would now consider for credit, because this act makes it prohibitive for you to give credit who need it and rewards you to give credit who don't. She said, you're right, of course. That's a consequence of the act.
It's not sustainable to give credit to people that will not be able to pay in the future.
Okay, can I just...
But they used to. Before the act, small black businesses were the main credit receivers in South Africa. Now the doors have shut.
Okay.
Minute.
Hi. I actually have quite a few questions to multiple members of the panel. So I'm going to start with, I've just made a few notes. One question to just give me 2 minutes. I promise I won't be on. Firstly, I'd like to make a comment to Ryan. Ryan... Shame. Your plan is unworkable in South Africa because over 60% of our population is unskilled. Your plan assumes so many things they're actually laughable at this point. When you say we need to automate things, you need to understand when you automate things in fact, you're killing unemployment. You're killing employment. You have to balance that the society actually needs. Your plan assumes everybody is rich and it works on so many assumptions which are not practical to that context. Hold on, I've got a few more other questions to the other members of the panel. Cool. Cas, just want to question regarding Basa and also to Leon as well, regarding your black market context. There's something called in banking, retail banking, we like to call, I actually work for a bank, so I have a fairly good insight. It's called unsecured lending. That's what we're selling to the black market. We're selling products. We're actually creating a system worse than the Americans are. The rates that we're giving to actually black people, we're indebting them. So before you get on the high horse of we are actually helping black people, we're giving them black people who can't afford to pay an unnecessarily ungodly amount of money. We're indebting our nation. That's what we're actually doing. What we should be doing is focusing on businesses. Which you'll be fine. I actually work for a retail bank, so I'm going to give it to you from my perspective and our focus. Our company, I can't mention it because of that, our company is spending more resources on unsecured lending than they are on SME development, which should be our focus. That's what banks should be doing. Anything less is unacceptable in South Africa at this current moment. It is an injustice that we as bankers lend to people who are not creating jobs, who are not adding value. It should be a crime in South Africa. The first regulation should be a crime, is to actually, industries that are growing, we also need to support employment. We need to support education. Those are the things we actually need to focus in. Banking. That's what banking's core focus, retail banking. Because guess what? There are 9 million taxpayers in South Africa and 40 million people under social welfare. We should be aiming, that 9 million should be working towards helping the others. By focusing on that, that's how we're going to eradicate poverty. That's what that's fun for. My last question, give me a moment. Leon, quick question.
I'm not going to give you the mic again.
Please, sorry. God, thank you. I'm so sorry. I'm sorry for the rudeness, but I think this needs to be said. Leon, your comment about you being against the Occupy movement, I'd like to know there's no such thing as development without exploitation. And that's what certain rich members, not all of them, do. And inequality, if we continue with inequality, unfortunately, this is how it's going to be. If we continue to preach inequality and we let it continue, we will have civil wars. We will have utter destruction. That's what we will have in this country if we continue it. So I'm sorry, you've got to work for creating...
Tell me what you mean by equality.
Inequality. See, you may have
commented. What do you mean by equality?
Equality is that we need to bring our members, society's worst members.
Same income for everyone.
No, society's worst members. I never said same income for everyone. That's not what I believe in. But we should be creating, bring them forward. We should be bringing them with us. Not necessarily.
But I agree with that. That means inequality.
Okay, can I just ask the panel members, what I would like to do now? I'm just going to take two questions. And if when you respond to this, you can just make it to be part of your conclusion. I just have a few comments that things that I would like for you to also comment on. So I'm just going to take a question from this gentleman. And then another one there. Oh, he's gone. He's still there. Okay.
Okay. I think mine is a bit of a continuation from the comment from the last speaker. And then I just a little difference is that I'm not talking about equality, because equality applies in as far as the constitution goes. We are all equal in front of the law, but we all are not economically equal. We are economically different, and I think what we should move towards is an equitable society where the difference between the haves and the have-nots is not as vast as it is. And I think it's the pursuit of lots of wealth that brings in greed, which influences executive pay, which executive pay and bonuses led to some of the challenges that we saw in the globe today. So for me, capitalism has proven not to work, because the same underlying principle of the too much for myself and myself only coming first at all times and at all costs has brought us disaster. Because all those senior bank executives that delivered to the world the issues that we're dealing with today, all what they were pursuing was outright sheer self-interest. So we have seen what self-interest is able to do. And what we must then decide. And I think it's also maybe slightly irresponsible to say that the pay of people must be determined by the shareholder and all that. I think we must then decide what type of South Africa or country or nation do we want to create for ourselves. To say, leave it to the shareholder to determine, it's easy to say. But the consequences of doing that are very negative and severe to all. So I think what we should do as we deal with these issues is to look at what are the things that we should start and what are the things that we should reduce and what are the things that we should stop to create a reasonable, equitable society. I'm for an equitable society, not an equal society.
Can I ask if you can just... Okay. You've broken the mind.
This should most probably be my voice.
Okay, yeah. If you can just go straight to the question. No comment, question.
My name is Michael. I'm from PP and attorneys. I just need to address a question to, I think, the two gentlemen here. You have touched on two issues, especially developmental challenges as well as heavy regulation within the banking sector. What I need to know from you, I've actually listened to the debates going on and a whole lot of issues have been touched, but what I need to know from you guys, a way forward is, does this border, especially you mentioned the issues of National Credit Act, that impedes a lot that has imposed difficulties within the banking sector, does it bother you? And if it does, do you have any plans to ensure that situations like this do not happen again, a way forward? Or are you as a banking sector playing the innocent guy in such a way that if the law comes to you, no matter how draconian it could be in terms of how you perceive it, you will implement that without having to challenge, without having to question that? Thank you.
Okay, I'll be very quick. I have a comment and a question very quickly. I actually disagree with Mr. Leon Louw, but I disagree with him on many things. But one is what as well Dr. Marco agreed on, that sustainability is not the responsibility of banks, or maybe banks are not accountable for it. And I believe that banks can play a huge role in terms of ensuring green or sustainability in terms of how they make their investment decisions in the future. Obviously, they can't happen on their own free will if, for instance, the profit considerations are not the same as saying other more polluted projects, for instance. So I think that's where regulation needs to come in. But in essence, I believe that banks, since they are the source of capital, they have a huge role to play in terms of a kind of like inspiring technologies and developments that would actually preserve the environment. My question is to Dr. Marco Lotz. You said that nedbank capital is an index that tracks performance in the green economy or something like that. I would like to know what, for instance, what are the incentives for businesses to kind of like, be sustainable in lack of, say, for instance, an international agreement on, you know, how sustainability or carbon emissions will be tracked.
Yeah.
What I'm going to do now, the gentleman was standing here, I think he realized that we need more time. So I don't know on your side if you have any commitments, because I don't want to extend this discussion and realize that you've got other commitments. Okay, because initially...
There is coffee here at the front, so if you want to go and get coffee quickly, you're more than welcome to bring in the cups as well. If you want to come and collect coffee, just make it available for you.
Okay, that's fine.
We have commitments in the form of catching aeroplanes.
Okay.
So let's finish this.
Can I just get time would be suitable for you to leave?
Kind of like Mark.
And that's fine. I think what we're going to do is, I'm just going to take maybe few questions, and then you can summarize. Maybe we can start with you, okay? Because you've got time commitments, and then maybe we can excuse you. Is that fine?
Okay. Can you excuse us now? Can I?
No.
Yeah.
Okay. No, that's fine.
I think that from Dean Catamarans, thank you for the opportunity of being able to sponsor this. And a very big thank you to Dr. Gowans. We in actual fact, were led to believe that we could do presentations pertinent to our industry, and we had prepared that. I have not had sight of the questions that are in something, a book over there. We've never had sight of that, but nevertheless, it's a great event to network. We intend to do that, but we need to get onto, or Dr. Gowans needs to get onto an aeroplane. Thank you for listening to us, very interesting. I hope you guys don't kill one another in here. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening. Thank
you as well.
Cape Town to the sea.
We've got to clean up the mess all the Gautengers left in
our city.
Okay, that's fine. You can do it. The question was just around the charges or the costs that we incur to import and export. Are they comparable in relation to what is happening across the globe?
For us to export into some countries?
Yeah, in the ports.
In the ports.
Yeah, the costs that we have in the ports.
We are going through a huge... we're going through a very large international survey of what our costs are. What has just happened in the last 12 hours is that we've reduced the costs to South African industry of something in the region of 30 billion of the costs through the ports of our exports, and that should have a significant effect on our export potential. Answer your question?
I think it does to a great extent, but I'm also wondering what is the key impact of that on Transnet, for example, to incur all this capital expenditure that was promised on the 22nd?
I would leave Transnet to answer that question. I think they may need to cut back on the expense of what they're doing and maybe take it a little longer. There is a requirement for investment in the ports, but not at the expense of the exportability of South African product.
Thank you, Doc.
Okay, safely.
Why are you
taking
the platform for your own?
I'm probably going to take some few questions, but maybe what you can do, if you can just respond to some of the questions that have been raised.
I would like to respond to the gentleman about posing the question about why should banks be sustainable.
Sorry, just maybe before you respond, can you, the panelists, if you can just talk about bank charges as well, your views on these, because the standards have been dipping. I would like to know your views on bank charges.
Okay, bank charges is a bit of a curveball, coming from a left field, since I didn't expect that to be on this panel, yes. But let's also be pretty honest about banking fees. Banks also keep each other honest. If somebody drops a banking fee, somebody will move to that bank. So banking charges, as Cas also alluded to, if we have to do the following, get 70 copies of our ID book, have 20 forms filled in, have an additional 12 pages signed, then there will be banking charges. And that is the simple truth of it. If we want to streamline the banking system, yes, banking charges can be reduced, but look, it's an inevitable part of anything else. If you buy a can of tuna, there's a markup on that because there's charges in logistics and all of that comes with it. So the question for me is not so much whether there should be banking charges. The question should be, first of all, does the different banks keep each other honest enough? And second of all, are there any space to reduce the banking charges? And that's a completely open debate, but I can promise you the first bank that can nail that one will reduce the banking fees and they will get more client base. Up to that point, it's not that the green, the blue, the turquoise, and the red bank sits in a smoky bar lounge and they decide about the banking charges. It's a bit more complex.
But it should be interrogated. And can I move on to the question posed by?
Yeah, you can move on. And but maybe before you move on, please, you just need to understand that one of the things that the bank charges, they came, people were complaining about these things before FICA and all these rules. Before we spoke about this consumer protection, they were there.
Thank you.
This is just a comment.
Fine, so I can't answer a comment. I need a question, so I'll go back to the question posed. The question posed is, why should banks be sustainable?
Not quite. I first started by arguing that banks have a role to play in sustainability.
Sure.
And then my question then was, you said nedbank capital is an index that tracks green performance or performance in companies. So I asked, what's the incentive for those companies to be sustainable in the last 10 quality, in level C, in international agreement on how to track and reward sustainability?
Okay, that's a good question. And let me point it this way. We don't need an international agreement on climate change for Mr. G to be upset. We don't need international agreement for the client base to be so upset about the bank's funding of a mining system or funding of something that's not sustainable to move their account somewhere else. And that specific index of nedbank capital actually proved that if you invest in green companies or more sustainable companies, that you don't have to forfeit profit. You can actually make money by being more sustainable. So it's not a top-down approach that I need a legally binding Kyoto second commitment period or extension of the first commitment period to enforce what I should do locally and by implication what I can fund. The client base is getting more and more educated. It's putting more and more pressure on any and all banks to actually be extremely sustainable, and that's very, very good pressure to have. It's an excellent position, and the man on the street is really recognizing the power they have in determining what the bank will fund. But remember, getting back to the points raised on my right hand side, and that is a bank's money comes from institutional investors, that will be pension funds. So sometimes we do get this idea that some green organizations will say, let's levy only a 1% charge on certain investments, and that money we then use to green certain institutions. And then it sounds like a good idea, but if I tell you I'm going to drop your pension fund in income by 1%, then all of a sudden it's not such a good idea. So it's really the institutional investors and the client's money. And that will also determine how sustainable a lot of the funding can be. I can't on the one hand say a bank shouldn't fund stuff that isn't sustainable or green, and on the other hand say that they're not allowed to use my pension fund money. Because what money should they then use? And that's a difficult situation that we're in. But being sustainable is at this stage not a burden. It's an enormous opportunity. But getting back to the point raised previously, this is not corporate social spend. This should be sound financial business models that has also got a green or sustainable angle. And I want to close there, and I would like to speak to the webinar sub questions afterwards.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Right, first of all, you did not get born to be a banker. You were born to dream and aspire. Okay, so what we propose is that people can aspire to be what they really want to be, not sit behind a sewing machine for 8-9 hours a day.
12.
There we go. That's exploitation. Okay. So what we're saying is we have the capabilities, we have the technology that we can create millions of T-shirts per day. It's just a small example. Please take it into other sectors. And provide those T-shirts to people because a machine sat there and made it. Okay. Cotton picking has now become mechanized. Banking is electronic, but it's actually mechanized. You don't sit there and write the debits and credits like you used to. And what we're saying is that all those needless jobs that have been created under the guise of exploitation can be eliminated, all right? So that the real jobs that are really creating value for people, not for business, for people and their livelihood and their let's say training and development skills of their life can be focused on, thus also helping other people to work less hours per day to fit in the extra people that have come from the other markets. You with me? So that You can also go back to studying, go and study things you want to do, or pursue hobbies, sports, whatever you want to achieve in your life. Not that, oh, now everyone is rich and, it's okay, it's fine. The doctor wanted to become a doctor so that he could help people. That is the essence of what we're talking of. Doing things to the benefit of humanity, not the degradation of the environment or people. Okay?
Okay, so I mean, if you... please don't skip Leon.
No, I'm not. I'm switching on the microphone.
Leon, just when you conclude, I would just like you to also just talk about when you were dealing with the credit crunch, you said it was mainly caused by the government because of its regulations. And one of the points that you mentioned was, for example, you spoke about those agencies that were created by the government, which are in essence saying that if the bank is lending to the poor guy from the slums, then they've got a guarantee. And you say that is the reason why we had a problem. Okay. Yeah. And for that reason, you would have expected the banks to say, look, okay, instead of going under, we should be getting money from the government because they provided a guarantee. Am I right?
Yes.
But why did Lehman Brothers go under?
Yes, that's interesting. The reason the bubble burst, just to get that out of the way quickly, for what it's worth, and it's not meant as an insult, it's meant to say that it's simple. I produced a thing which is freely available on the internet, which has been widely republished and distributed around the world, a two-page explanation of the entire thing, called Idiot's Guide to the Financial Crisis. And I did a roadshow for some of the banks around the country explaining this to their investors and people generally. So it's something I've specialized in, this crisis, and I think I know as much as almost anybody about it. And the answer is, what happened is the bubble started bursting, which means property values started falling. That was the so-called bubble. Was the property market, the real estate crisis. When people believed the government would not be able to honor the obligation, what was originally called government backing and then called implicit government backing. And then what happened is the government kept propping it up. When Lehman Brothers collapsed, it was because those subprime mortgages collapsed, and when they went, as they did, to the government to say, where's the backing now, they were turned down. Which is why the bubble burst, is because people didn't believe the government would honor the backing. That's what they believed. And Lehman Brothers was the first casualty. Then when they came, then the next few came, then in fact over 100 American banks have in fact been wound up, Lehman Brothers just the biggest. When the other big ones came, they did in fact honor the backing. In other words, there's this $1 trillion, more than a trillion deficit. That was in fact the government trying to honor its obligation to the banks to underwrite the subprime mortgage derivatives. The biggest one of it was called CDSs, credit default swaps, which were heavily geared and so on and so forth. If anyone wants to know what all of those technical terms are, I'm quite happy to explain it, or it's available on stuff I've written on the internet. The couple of questions which were directed at me. Firstly, the gentleman over here said capitalism didn't work, it's a disaster. I'm not sure what you mean. As we sit here now, the capitalist countries are by far the wealthiest in the world. They're the ones to which the non-capitalist countries go begging for aid and get aid, which is a bad thing, incidentally, because the countries with aid have low growth and the countries without aid have high growth. There's very clear empirical evidence to that effect. And the reason why countries with aid have low growth is, think about it for a moment, it's what's called government-to-government aid. And the whole history of aid was actually the Cold War. It had nothing to do with trying to help poor people. It was the way to fight the Cold War. And what happened is the government-to-government aid essentially says to somebody, if you are the cabinet of a country, what the rich countries say is, if you manage to cause more poverty than he does, we'll give you money. So it's a direct reward for causing poverty. That's what aid is. If you're better at causing poverty than someone else, you get more money. So it's a very strange thing, this aid. It's not aid to people, bearing in mind. It's not as if the aid goes to SMEs or to build clinics or schools or whatever, it's aid to the people who cause the poverty, the governments. So the point about it is the capitalist countries are by far the wealthiest. Capitalism has got nowhere near having failed. It's still growing. The capitalist countries are still growing faster. In Africa, which is of course for great excitement, by the way, I would encourage everyone now to become aware of this. Africa, sub-Saharan Africa, is now the highest growth region in the world. And many, many African countries are now growing at spectacular rates, like Ghana, which is growing at 8, 9, 10, maybe this year 12%. And Ghana, by the way, is the country in the world that has made the biggest shift of any country on earth from being an unfree to being a free economy. In other words, Ghana has gone a huge leap into being a capitalist economy, and the economy has taken off like a rocket. So when you look at it, China has created these ultra-capitalist special economic zones, which is where 85% of their investment and growth is. So all around the world, India is growing high because of its reforms of the mid-90s. And wherever you look around the world, capitalist economies, especially the previously socialist economies that have become capitalist, are booming, including in Africa, which shows Africa is no special case. Africa is like anywhere else. If you have good policies, you get rewarded. So there's nothing about Africa that's different. Then on the question you raise about you want equity, not inequality, let me just say, I do too. And the great American economist Walter Williams, I encourage any of you to look him up, and I mention, I hate to say this, but in the context of South Africa, I'm going to say it anyway, happens to be black. He's a black economist, and my very favorite economist in the whole world happens to be another black economist, Thomas Sowell. But nonetheless, Walter Williams puts it this way, very beautifully. He says, an equitable distribution of wealth is when you get to decide what happens to your wealth and I get to decide what happens to mine. That's equitable. Now, let's make that big. When somebody goes to a bank and what are the banking charges, you see, I think the banking charges should be regulated. Strictly, heavily regulated in the extreme. And the best kind of regulation I know of is called competition. I would like banking charges to be exposed to maximal deregulated competition, which I trust a great deal more than a bureaucrat to drive banking charges down. At the moment, what the bureaucrats have done is the opposite. Is they've regulated the banks, which does two things. One is drives banking charges up, and secondly, increases inequality, because it makes it unprofitable to lend to the poor and profitable to lend to the rich. In other words, what we now have is an intensifying set of regulations, increasing inequality and discriminating against the poor, which I consider inequitable. I would like equity, which is where the banks cannot get away with charging high charges because they will lose to competitors.
So the two of you, Leon, agree?
We agree, but beneath it there's some nuances of disagreement, but we agree. I also agree with the lady there who wants more equality. I want more equality. The way to get more equality is to have more freedom. Now, every black South African should know that. It was to get rid of apartheid. It was the first most important thing you do to get more equality, is get rid of the thing that keeps you down. At the moment, we have things that keep the poor down, which unfortunately in South Africa does have a racial appearance. But it's not black or white, it's the poor of any color, any kind, are being held down by our regulatory environment. Then, Michael, you made the point of the only one who named himself, so Michael the lawyer. Let me just make this observation about somebody else raised, I think it was that gentleman there, that the regulations saved us from the crisis. There's a timing issue here. Our National Credit Act came into force at the time the bubble was bursting. In other words, after the bubble was caused. Couldn't have had anything to do with it at all. And it's completely irrelevant, and we never had a subprime mortgage policy here. We did, by the way, just technically speaking. Cass will know that in the financial sector charter, and he's like one of the big people there, we were committed to provide something like 72 billion rands of low income. But what happened is the government was meant to back it, underwrite it, as in America, and Trevor Manuel never got around to doing it. And I like to think it's because he was clever. Some people might think it's because he was lazy. I think he just thanks to him, we didn't lend money to people who can't pay. The banks have lent money to the poor, but to people who are sustainable and viable. And they are being prevented from doing that by these regulations. So then, finally, I do want to say that I would love a world in which people are equal, and you used the right word, equality at law. Equality at law means you cannot be equal in other senses. The only way to make people equal in senses other than law is to make them unequal at law. In other words, the natural response of freedom and rights is that some people do better than others. I strongly suspect I, as it happens, am at the very low end of the income-earning people in this room. However, if you want equal consequences as opposed to equal rights, you can't have equal rights. You can't have equal rights and equal consequences. The two are mutually exclusive. You have to choose one or the other. If we want equality in South Africa, then we must accept inequality as a necessary consequence, but I might also say a virtuous consequence. That is to say, the people who serve us better, the Bill Gateses of the world, the bankers of the world, the inventors of the world, the singers, the sports players, the authors, very, very, very wealthy people. I am in favor of the people who write best-selling books being obscenely wealthy. I want them to write fabulous books. And if we try to prevent people who write, authors who write fabulous books being very, very wealthy, we won't get fabulous books. We won't get fabulous movies. We won't get great sport. We won't get great... We won't have the Michael Jacksons of the world or the Oprah Winfreys of the world if we are anti-wealth. It is thanks to their wealth, the ability to be wealthy, that we have had the fabulous benefits of inventors, entertainers, suppliers, retailers, importers, exporters, and I am in favor of their wealth to the extent that it makes my life and your life better.
Okay, the facilitator is asking me to try and wind the thing down as quickly as possible. Let me try and do that. Just a few closing comments, and seeing I don't have time to respond to the specific questions. But just to say, guys, when the problem I have with the tenor of the debates we have around these things is that there are people here who say, well, no matter what you say, I'm not an high horse. No matter what you say, we don't trust the banks. But if you don't trust the banks, don't put your money there. Simple. Don't put your money there. Okay? You trust them enough to put your money there safely. Then people sit here and say, no, we don't trust them. They do this and they say they do this and they say it, and they're not doing it. Now, let me just take the unsecured credit stuff. You know, we position this as if banks are giving credit and putting people into over-indebtedness. If bank isn't going to give me credit if I don't walk into a bank looking for credit. Okay, so let's also put some responsibility on borrowers. Okay, where's the bulk of this unsecured credit going according to NCR figures? It's not going to poor people. It's going to the average, it's going average monthly income, 20,000 rand per household. That's where the bulk of this unsecured credit is going.
Yeah.
And these are people who got into trouble during the crisis, who have maxed out their credit cards, who have buggered up their credit record so they can't get excess bonds and so on, and are now going for unsecured credit. So the other reason why banks are doing this is Basel III is coming. Okay, the liquidity requirements of Basel III is going to kill medium and long-term lending in this country. So banks are shifting their market. Regulation. Okay, so there's a borrower and there's a lender. Nobody forces me to borrow money. If I know I can't afford it, I shouldn't be borrowing money. Okay? Just let me, education, job creation, and so on. These are the things that take up a lot of my time at the banking association. But it is not the job of banks to educate children. It's government's job to educate children. Business puts about 1.5 billion rand a year into education, every year. What's the impact of that? Bugger off.
Because the bottom line is that until we get our school system sorted out, we don't take care of the skills problem in this country. There's no shortcuts to these things. One of the South African diseases that we want shortcuts to these things. Until we put money and management and proper facilities into schools and get schools to run properly, and I'm talking about public schools, to run properly, we're not going to skill people in this country. It's not the bank's problem, it's not business's problem, it's not government's problem, it's our problem. So, what do banks know about education? Job creation. It's not banks. Banks do not directly create jobs, they don't produce anything. Okay, but we say to cool our finance, for instance, guys, work with us. The problem we have in banks, and you work for banks, maybe you have a different experience. But a lot of people walk into banks looking for enterprise finance, do not have good business plans, do not have collateral. Okay? We tell Kula, if there's a good business plan, we are willing to fund the bank. The person doesn't have collateral, will come to you for guarantees. Okay? But what do we do about people who have business ideas but do not know how to manage their businesses? Now, is it the bank's job to do that? It's certainly the bank's job to work with government and others to tackle that problem, which we try to do all the time. So we just have to stop talking past each other on these issues. These are national crises. The banks have a critical role to play in them because they are, as somebody said, the holders of capital. Okay? But whether it's for green economy, whether it's for responsible investment, whether it's for SMEs, whether it's for housing, we are not going to lend money if we don't get that money back. End of story. We are not going to do it. Because that's what created the problems in those jurisdictions. We've lent close on to 70 billion rand into the low-income housing market in the last 8 years. We've lent that money because it was good lending. And we're getting that money back. If it wasn't good lending, we would not have lent that money. We would have worked with government and others to say, look, this is what we need to do to improve that market. And you guys need to do some work in it. But until that is done, we would not have lent that money. Now, if anybody wants us to lend money for the sake of lending money without worrying about whether it's coming back or not, open a bank and do it, guys. See how long you last.
Thanks, Cas.
Okay? But let's just stop talking past each other. In collaborating, we'll solve this problem. In not trusting each other, we'll be sitting here talking in 10 years' time of our senses.
Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to thank you for coming to this. I think we are the only people who are left in this building. But maybe before we leave, if we can just put our hands together for our panelists. I thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.